Cujo? Cujo?
In 1983 is Louis Teague's Cujo based on Stephen King's same name novel from 1981. Here Saint Bernard Cujo, Indian for unstoppable force, becomes infected with rabies. When the disease breaks out, he kills a neighbor and his owner, whose family is on vacation. When a mother, who has moved to Castle Rock from New York with her husband and child, pulls into his remote farm with auto repair shop with a broken car, the engine dies and she barely escapes a dog attack. Trapped for nights in her vehicle, which gets hotter during the day, she has to watch helplessly as her 6-year-old son slowly dies of thirst. After Cujo kills on the third day a policeman on the search for her, she decides to face the monster. Cujo is one of the extremely rare good Stephen King adaptations. Movie and book are both excellent and similar in plot, but not identical. And I prefer, as usual, the more detailed novel, in fact a continuation of The Dead Zone, whose events form the introduction, and in which some passages are also written from the point of view of the sick dog, who also doesn't get up a second time at the end after being speared with a baseball bat only to be shot, and in which the 4-year-old child does not survive. When the life gets into your heart, baby, don't you forget about me. The town of Castle Rock in the book universe is not exactly like the ones in the movies, which often cause some confusion for viewers who only know the adaptations due to different details. The same name 20-part TV series from 2018, where Stephen King served as a consultant, is not based on a specific King template, but merely on his works and characters in general. In the movies, Castle Rock officially first appeared in Cujo in 1983, but strictly speaking in 1982 in Creepshow. At the end of the segment, The Lonely Death of Jordy Verrill, a signpost shows that Castle Rock is 5 miles away. In the books, however, it was already in 1979 in The Dead Zone, where the now dead Sheriff Bannerman was already investigating. He's also mentioned later in The Body from Different Seasons and The Dark Half. However, since the movie came out 2 months after Cujo, it looks like the sheriff suddenly resurrected in The Dead Zone. In Pet Sematary, Judd Crandall tells of a rabbit Saint Bernard who killed 4 people in Maine years ago. But in the movie verse, there are only 3. The Cujo book address, Town Road No. 3, confusingly incorrectly called Maple Sugar Road in the movie, is also where Polly Chalmers, the girlfriend of Sheriff Pangborn, sets a trap for Ace Merrill in Needful Things from 1991, believing she senses Cujo's ghost on the property. I'll be alone, dancing. In Fraser Clark Heston's so-called adaptation from 1993, Ace Merrill, like many other characters, doesn't even exist. Baby, don't you forget about me. Don't you forget about me. Here too, stranger Leland Gaunt opens a store in Castle Rock called Needful Things, where every customer finds an item they desire so much that they are willing to pay any price for it, which always includes an apparently harmless so-called prank against a fellow citizen, which deepen the conflicts that already exist in the city and have been smoldering for years, leading in the end to chaos and destruction. While the objects themselves, worthless trinkets and not what the buyer thinks he sees, become more and more valuable in the eyes of the owners, causing with time paranoia. Soon the situation escalates even with murder. Only Alan Pangborn, in the books Sheriff Bannerman's successor, who had already witnessed supernatural events thanks to the Dark Half, draws the right conclusions and manages to get rid of Gaunt, here with a lame speech, in the much more interesting book With White Magic, which is not only directly related to his experiences in the Dark Half. At one point he uses a sparrow attack. There he also used to be an amateur illusionist, which also explains why he is somewhat less receptive to Gaunt's illusions than the other citizens. In the much too well cast movie we find nothing of this sort. From my point of view it shares only some names with the original, since here so many important plotline sequences and details were completely changed or directly left out. For example, while the sheriff walks into Gaunt's store right at the beginning and has a chat with him, the demon in the book tries successfully to avoid him as long as possible until the final, since he knows that it is very difficult to corrupt him, what in the original mystery crime story extremely contributes to the build-up of tension, which with the appearance of the strange sinister slowly in the background the villagers corrupting power shares some similarities to Salem's Lot. The movie exists in addition to the 2-hour cinema version also in a 3-hour US TV version, toned down by violent scenes. Among other things, with a stupid car chase introduction in which Gaunt and the sheriff actually meet even earlier. So much for subtlety and suspense. Also a bit more information about the townspeople thanks to numerous scenes extensions, some slightly different arrangement of events and so on. Cujo also appears in Gerard's game.
Except Cujo over there?
As a stray dog that eats parts of the deceased Gerard corpse. However, in the same named 1992 book, his name is Prince. Some chapters similar to Cujo are also written from the dog's perspective. It's about a married couple who travel to a remote cabin to breathe with bondage games new life into their relationship. But Gerard dies unexpected while his wife is left helplessly tied up on the bed. Now Jessie tries to escape death, during which she seems to hallucinate voices and people, and caught up in her thoughts by the horror of her own past. Mike Flanagan's remarkably faithful, accidentally cast TV movie from 2017 tells, with some from my point of view, insignificant detail changes, in essence the same, this time slightly tightened story. This includes that he gets rid of some of Jessie's personalities and distributes them to the apparitions of a second Jessie and a revived Gerard. In addition, only there are allusions to The Shining and Bag of Bones. In the story there is a direct connection to Dolores Claiborne through childhood memories. During the 1963 eclipse, reality blurred and Jessie saw Dolores after she lured her husband into the well. Louis Teague is an American filmmaker born in 1938.
Hi, it's Louis Teague.
He started as a TV director in the 60s and in addition to his feature films, including several genre classics. For his second excellent King adaptation, Cat's Eye from 1985, see the short story special Night Shift, he repeatedly directed episodes for TV series. In the 70s he worked for the King of B-movies, Roger Corman, and was there, among other things, second unit director on Death Race 2000 or The Big Red One. But since the early 90s he made only TV movies until 2001. And last in 2010 some transgender reality sitcom whatsoever, only to be seen on his own YouTube channel as a so-called web series.
Don't you
In 1974, Leon Capitano and Louis Teague's unbearable cheap R-rated sexploitation crime drama comedy Dirty O'Neill is about a cop in a small California town with a fondness for women, who is forced into action when a trio of homicidal thugs invade the town. The unusually ambitious 1979 comic production The Lady in Red tells the crime story of a poor 1930s farmer's daughter who goes to Chicago, where she is jailed, works as a prostitute, falls in love with the notorious outlaw John Dillinger, witnesses his death, and at the end eventually attempts a bank robbery. The well-cast, interesting R-rated drama, with an early screenplay by later well-known independent filmmaker John Sayles and first score by later multi-award-winning star composer James Horner, was not a success at the box office and made with a $400,000 budget only $900,000 back. In 1980, Alligator spreads fear and terror on screens. In this R-rated eco-horror, a Chicago cop, with the help of a reptile expert, tries to solve the case of mysterious body parts that have been appearing more and more frequently in connection with the sewers. The killer turns out to be a man-eating alligator, which apparently has been living there since he was flushed down the toilet years earlier, and now mutated into a giant thanks to illegal disposed medical waste from hormone research. This can-alligator can escape after an unsuccessful drive hunt and now attacks the people. The movie made its estimated $1.5 million budget more than four times back and received mostly positive feedback. The entertaining insider tip, which doesn't always take itself quite seriously, with a high trash factor and nice practical effects, and again based on a John Sayles script, is for me the best among the crocodile horror flicks. I would even say the only really interesting one. And is much better, similar to Piranha 2 years earlier, also a John Sayles script, than most of the other cheap Jaws clones. Just exactly the opposite as John Hess' 1991 direct-to-video to trash can Alligator 2, The Mutant. In the alleged sequel with alleged mutation, but in reality an ultra-lame remake in worse with poor effects, which takes itself far too seriously, with hardly any alligator and certainly no visible mutations whatsoever, but lots of filler like tons of wrestling scenes. Again, an alligator feeds on animals with growth hormones and mutating chemicals, again by a greedy company that has bought politicians, who again get the investigating police officer suspended, who again investigates on his own, and again sightings of the monster are not believed until it's too late. The R-rated crime action drama Fighting Back from 1982 is about a store owner in Philadelphia who organizes a neighborhood watch because of the increasing violence. His wife loses her child, his mother almost loses her life, and the completely overburdened police have practically given up on the neighborhood. What he doesn't expect, however, is the resistance that not only the criminals but also the local politicians put up against the group, as they simply put the actions of his team as racial discrimination. So the same as nowadays. The movie is a decent, well-cast kind of more realistic Death Wish variation, which at costs of $9 million made only $6 million back and was a flop. Louis Teague's 1985 The Jewel of the Nile follows up Robert Zemeckis' extremely charming, entertaining adventure hit from the previous year, with the same cast in the three lead roles. In Romancing the Stone, which made $115 million worldwide at a $10 million budget, romance novelist Joan Wilder has to leave her comfort zone and sets out for Colombia to trade her kidnapped sister for a treasure map, and gets thereby in the middle of a dangerous adventure in which she goes of necessity with the exotic bird smuggler Jack Colton on treasure hunt. In the much weaker sequel, Joan leaves her boyfriend Jack, who wants to travel on his boat around the world, to write a biography for an Arab statesman in Africa. Jack and Ralph, the swindler from part 1, discover that this is in fact a power-hungry dictator. He also blows up Jack's boat, which allegedly also stole a precious jewel, so they follow Joan to save her. In the meantime, she herself discovers his villain plans and finds out that the Jewel of the Nile is not a diamond, but some guy, who is dragged along from now on because allegedly somehow important. Also something with revolution, whatever. The second half seems as if the two-page script was already over. Bored to death next to the Nile, had more than double the costs, 25 million, but couldn't even make 100 million back. Not only the horrible soundtrack is annoying as fuck, but even more so the completely uninteresting plot, obviously imagined by a 5-year-old, in which in the final our dictator wannabe tries to convince simple-minded believers with a special effects show that he is the chosen one. For sure not chosen was this Snorefest, which got, let's put it politely, not quite as good reviews as the innovative predecessor. The only thing worth mentioning here is actually its funny phone call in the desert trailer, and probably Billy Ocean's end credits hit, when the going gets tough, with the three main actors singing along in the background. In 1989, the action comedy Collision Course is about a Detroit police officer who has to cooperate with a colleague from Japan to solve a murder related to a stolen Japanese motor prototype. I saw the silly flick back then on video because of Pat Morita and immediately forgot about it because of Jay Leno. And after 30 years, it didn't really get better. 1990, Navy SEALs, a US special unit in the same named military propaganda schlock flop, free American hostages from Arab terrorists in the Middle East, as if there had ever been any others, and destroy a weapons depot in a second mission. Since recently, not the occupiers and invaders of a foreign country are the terrorists, but its inhabitants who defend it. The ridiculous, unbearably embarrassing, pathetic by the numbers action flick made with a $21 million budget, only 25 million back, and received quite rightly mostly negative feedback. In 1991, the TV science fiction thriller Wedlock had a theatrical release only in some countries, like here in Germany, and also appeared under the title Deadlock. In an undefined future, Frank is betrayed by his accomplices after a diamond heist, but he is able to hide the loot in time and sent to an experimental prison, in which the inhabitants, men and women, probably that's why it's called Camp Holiday, wearing paired electronic neck collars, which explode if you move more than 100 meters away from your secretly kept partner. Frank finds out who he is paired with. As you walk on by. And to escape the harassment of the warden, who, of course, is after the diamonds, he breaks out together with his female collar partner. Oh, will you call my name? But actually, she breaks out and drags him along without being asked. Frank is here constantly only reacting and rarely acting. As if he, much like the viewer, has no desire to be here at all. Everything is done here to avoid any kind of tension. We see quite early that the director is working with the ex and of course with his collar partner. The quite obviously the defined ones and the running man inspired, unfortunately far too harmless cheap trash without a real story, especially with the laughable prison scenes and the sets clearly show the lack of budget, benefits only from the interesting cast, which is totally wasted here.